Hello and welcome to the third part of the tutorial series on making a space shooter game in Defold. Of course, I encourage you to check out the previous video or start from the first one in this series. At this point, we already have a working prototype where we can fly and shoot projectiles and enemies can be destroyed on hit. But it's not so juicy to call it a game. So let's pump it up with some visual effects utilizing Defold's particle system, adding sound effects, and finally adding a graphical user interface. Let's start with explosion effects. We can use a sprite approach and just play the destruction animation when the enemy ship is destroyed. Or we could create a particle effect for this, that will be always random. Or we could mix the two solutions. So at first in our project prepare the animation of the ship destruction in the same way as we prepared animations for static images of ships. Create a new animation and add all images. But this time add the whole sequence of frames from the assets we are using. I already added the images to our Atlas folder. The order here is the actual order of the animation, so you could adjust it using Alt and Up or Down keys combination, or even duplicate some frames if needed. We always used one playback mode up to now, but for actual animations we should choose a playback to play the whole animation once in forward direction. We also should adjust the frames per seconds property for the animation. You can preview the animation with a space key. When the animation is added, we should play it when the enemy ship is destroyed, and if we remember correctly, we delete the ship in the script when a collision with a bullet happens. So add here a line utilizing sprite.playflipbook function from sprite API that allows us to play any animation on any sprite component. We would like to play on the sprite component of this object, so again we will use a relative address here only. And we would like to play animation with ID enemyDev, as we set it up in the Atlas like this. But when we start playing animation, the object will be deleted immediately. Moreover, the sprite play flipbook is not a blocking function here, so we should delete it after the animation is completed. Here comes a very useful feature of adding a third optional argument, which is a callback function triggered when animation is completed. This sensibly only works for playback modes that are playing the animation only once, which is our case. So add an anonymous function here and move the go.delete call inside. Check if everything is working in the game. If so, let's spice it up with some particle effects. Particle effects is another component in Defold that is already very powerful. It has its own editor view with a lot of properties to tune for an infinite possibilities to make some cool effects. It is also the only component as of now that utilizes the curve editor you can see in the bottom pane of the Defold editor. That is designed to animate some properties over the lifetime of particles. At first, we will start playing with the particle editor. When our rocket hits the ship, it will explode with an effect we create. So add a particle resource to our asset and it will be opened in a particle editor. Again, with the space key, we start or stop particles emission. By default there is one emitter here. It's okay, but let's change its type to a spherical one. I encourage you to play a little bit with all those properties and see how they affect your particles. We want it a little bit more contained, so we slow down the initial speed and decrease the particle lifetime. Those parameters on the right side define the possible deviation from original value on the left, so we could generate different speeds and lifetimes for each particle. In the end, it's only an explosion, so those particles should be emitted immediately at once. Change the play mode to once and make the duration very small. Note that the emission space is by default set to world, which is okay in this case because we could then delete the bullet carelessly because the particles will be already emitted to the world and not this object's local space. Also, increase the spawn rate a little bit so we could have more particles. Notice there is an upper cap for this, max particle count, defined as 128, which is totally okay for us now. It now looks like a smoke, so tune up the initial colors to make it more red or orange by reducing initial green and blue values. It's better. You could also modify the color in the lifetime of the particle, not only at the start. Check out the live color properties, for example the red one. If you click on this button, you will add a curve for this value and it will appear in the curve editor. You can use mouse wheel to zoom and the middle mouse button to pan the chart. Live alpha was already here, This curve defines that the particle gently appears and vanishes when it's near its lifetime. This is a normalized scale here, so 1 is end of the particle and 0 is the beginning here. You see, the red line is a constant function, so if we drag and drop the nodes, we can modify the curve. If we add such curves to all color values, the particles will vanish into black near the end, which is a pretty nice effect. You could play a little bit more here, polishing the explosion, adding maybe some custom image for particles, adding some emitters, or even playing with modifiers, it's up to you. Now open our bullet game object and add component file. Select our explosion particle effects and verify if the scale of the effect is okay, again playing with space key. Jump to the script of our bullet and where we delete the object on contact, add a line to trigger particles called particleEffects.play, where as an argument we again provide a relative path to our particle effects component, which is called explosion. Check out if it is triggered in the game when you hit the ship. At this point I am thankful for the comment of Lev Ivanov in the previous video, who pointed out that if the bullets did not hit the ship, they are not removed, so are stacked above the visible area, which is an obvious oversight of mine that we should fix ASAP. We will utilize again the power of a callback function, this time at the end of the animation playing, that animates the position of our bullet. Notice the order of the arguments and the other optional one here, called delay, which is a delay time for triggering the actual animation, by default 0, so leave it. And inside the anonymous callback function, add simply a call to delete this game object. Also a note here, you noticed most of the time we provide to which exact object or component we want a function to be applied, like with playing animation of specific sprite or specific particle effects. But in delete function we deliberately did not provide any argument, because I know, and now you too, that by default it deletes this game object to which this script belongs, and because we add script to each game object it deletes those game objects. Last part of pumping up our effects is to add some juicy sounds of explosions. For this, I prepared a file in the waveform audio file format, so I will move it to our assets folder. Now we need to prepare, as with anything in Defold, a component for this sound. In the main folder, add a new component of type sound. I call it boom. The view in the editor for sound component is just a duplicated view of properties in this case. Select the sound resource to point to our included asset. Rest of the properties describe if the sound should be looped and how many times. It shouldn't in our case, it's just a single explosion, so leave it like this. The group could be later on useful if we would like to control multiple sounds in a group at once. For example, set the volume only for sound effects or only for music and so on. The gain is the actual volume of the sound. It's normalized between 0 and 1. Pan defines where we hear the sound, like from where the stereo sound comes from, where minus 1 is like it comes only from the left speaker and plus 1 is for the right speaker. Pit describes how fast the sound is played, for example 0.5 is half of the original tempo of the sound and 2.0 is a double speed. Okay, now add a newly created component as a component file to our enemy object and modify its script to play this sound when it is destroyed. So here add a function sound.play and point to the proper URL, in our case boom component. We can add more sounds and some background music then for practice. I will add for example a sound of a retro gunshot. Add a sound component quickly for such a resource. Add it to our player game object and trigger it in the script when the shot happens, so in our timer that ticks every second. For the background music, do the same. But now, when creating a sound component, modify its property to be looped and leave the loop count to 0, which means it will be looped infinitely. It can be, for example, added to our player game object or some other game object where we want to handle sound logic. It's pretty usual for some more complicated games. Don't forget to modify the script, so in our case, the player script, to play the music as soon as it is initialized and check it in the game. Sounds good. And the last part to juice up our game is to add the user interface. Defold offers tremendous user interface possibilities with its easy-to-use build blocks. There is a special component called exactly GUI created now. Call it main and check out what we can do here. The white frame depicts our game window. Here we can put our GUI and it will be displayed on top of our game. One by one we could add a few things to the GUI. You see, it has a pretty unusual form of the outline with some kind of folders in which we could create specialized things. The first one is for GUI nodes. We could add box, pie, text, template or particle effects nodes. Let's start with the first one. Box is a simple rectangular shape, which we can put anywhere, rotate, scale it or resize when manual size mode is selected. We could make it in the beginning enabled or disabled, visible or not, and we could assign a texture to it. Let's try it by showing, for example, how many leaves we have left. But first, specify it is using our game.atlas as a texture in the textures of the GUI. Then, in our box node, choose the texture of our ship. Because we were testing manual size mode, the image size is stretched to the defined size. You can either modify the dimensions or select the auto size mode. Let's put it somewhere here in the corner and add another node, this time of type text. You can freely define the hierarchy that will affect the position of your nodes. For example, this text node could be a child of our box node and we could move it a little bit to the right, but when we modify the position of the parent, the child will follow. Notice the editor is pointing out the unforgivable mistake. We didn't specify any font. As with textures, again, tell this GUI component to use a font you have. For example, the built-in system font, and then choose it as a font for our text node. I didn't go through other properties of the nodes, but you can experiment with them. For example, here you can modify the displayed text. Add one more text node to the other corner in which we could display the score. For us later on to easily distinguish between those nodes, as we would like to dynamically change those values displayed in the game, rename them to score and leaves. When you're done, don't forget to add the GUI to our main collection. You can add it to a separate game object called interface and add the component file of our GUI. When you run the game, it should be visible now. But wait, it's not changing when we destroy the ship. So let's code it. Now GUI components can have a special type of script, which is called GUI script. Add it as a resource among our assets and you see it looks identical to normal script. But here we cannot use game object API, but instead we have a powerful GUI API, which allows us to do the magic. The easiest way in Defold to communicate between components is to utilize Defold's powerful messaging system. In overall, it is very simple, but addressing might be very confusing. If you remember, we already sent our first message when we wanted to acquire input focus, but we never responded to any messages up to now. Remove everything but the onMessage function, and here just start with a simple print function to be shown when this script receives any message, and display what message ID it was. Open our GUI component back, and in its root properties, select the script to be our GUI script we just wrote. So let's try to send a message to the GUI script when we destroy the ship. Open the enemy script and when it is destroyed, send a message using msg.post to our GUI component. Now the address. Split the view and check out the main collection. We just put it here in a game object, we called it interface. And the component is called main. So type in interface hash, which represents that we are now specifying a component and following it with the component's name, in our case main. This address defines we will send the message to the main GUI component. Set the message ID to, for example, hello. Run the game, destroy the ship and check out the console output in the editor. Hello! We managed to send properly the message and receive it in the GUI script. Now the coding gets a little bit harder. The task is, when the ship is destroyed, increase our score and display it in the GUI. create a local variable called score and set it to 0. When we receive the message, increase it and use the gui.setText function to set the text on a node. Wait, what is node here? It is a unique identifier of the node to which we should apply this function. You can get this identifier with gui.getNode and as argument type the node's ID. We are talking about the text node called score. So type in score. It's very confusing, I agree. For me, this ID is unique enough, but Defold demands here a special node identifier. The second argument is way easier to define. It is just a string to display. You can use here our score variable instead. You don't need to worry that you are working with numbers as a score, and here you are passing it to an argument of type string. It will be casted automatically and properly displayed. Check it by yourself. Of course, this code is very simple. You should wrap it in an if block and check if you are answering to the proper message ID, for example enemy def, and also change the send message ID in enemy.script, so you can later on introduce more messages to your game, for example a one for your leaves count or so on. But I will leave the implementation for this to you as an exercise. Make your enemies shoot projectiles in your direction, like we did it the other way around, and when player ship is hit, send a message to GUI script and change the leaf count. When it's zero, show a game over screen and maybe even a replay button. In this very short tutorial series for beginners, we made a pretty basic Galaga clone. It could be improved, of course. There is no enemy movement, no AI, no abrogates and so on. But with the tools and knowledge you gained during this tutorial, you can really enhance it. That's a challenge, but I believe you are now ready to begin your journey. Don't forget the old library of Defold's documentation, API and examples. Don't forget about the tremendously friendly community around Defold on the official forum and Discord channel. You will also find me there, so we could hang out. Bye!